progress.
Okay, the second one is supply chain management. Okay, supply chain management encompass the planning and management. Okay, encompass the planning and management of all supply chain operations. So if we talk about supply chain management, so what we will do in supply chain management is doing planning and managing. Okay, planning and managing of all supply chain operations. Supply chain all supply chain operation is already mentioned in definition of supply chain. From sourcing, production, distribution, material handling, and storage. Okay, including coordination and collaboration with channel partners. Okay, so if we talk about supply chain management, we cannot separate our role in supply chain. So in traditional comprehension, supply chain is having a separate player role. Okay, so supplier is stand alone, production facility is stand alone, wholesale is stand alone, the retailer is stand alone. In contemporary definition of supply chain management, we use term coordination and collaboration. So what we will do in coordination and collaborations, we share our planning. Okay, so if we do our forecasting about our demands, so we have to coordinate and collaborate. Hello retail, hello suppliers, I have kind of forecast. Can you share your forecast? So in final terms, we can have a single forecast that used by two players. It's good. If we have one forecast that used by three players, it's better. If we have one forecast for all supply chains that we involve in, so it's very good. Okay. So terms of coordination and collaborations is important in supply chain management. Okay. Also integrates supply and demand management within and across companies. So there is term of coordination and collaboration, and there is terms of integrating. Okay. So integrating supply and demand, if we have kind of program that call ERP, enterprise resource planning, so we can manage and control all of supply chain activities in one software. So we can know about the supply activity, we can know about the sourcing activity, is it any trouble from first supplier, is it any trouble from second suppliers, we can monitor and control from one software. Okay. Unfortunately, we still can deliver ERP materials because actually ERP materials is not in our curriculum, but in an information system curriculum, IS. Actually, this year has to be, there is training and certification about ERP for lecturer and some students. But I think it's delayed because the information, they still don't have the speakers to deliver the materials. I'm quite disappointed because I'm expecting that if I have the certification in ERP, I want to share to you what kind of ERP, what is ERP, how to use ERP, something like that. Because once you involve in company, something like Schneider or maybe in Surabaya is Samator producing gas, they already use ERP for controlling all of supply chain activities. But don't be disgraced because I already give you many of materials that become a basics of ERP, something like SNOP, sales and operation planning, MRP, material requirements planning, MPS, master production scheduling. I already give you in PPIC. That's materials become basics to you once you enter the company and you have to use ERP. Okay, so don't be disgraced. Okay. I think these pictures is most of the time you watch and most of the time you read from many reference, whether is it offline or online materials, that mostly supply chain management is picturized by something like this, okay? Which is factory. Before the factory, there is a supplier that supply raw materials into the factory. Then factory deliver the finished product into distribution center. There is a picture of ship and train. These two is transportation mode. Okay, these two is transportation mode. There is train, there is ship, there is car, there is motorcycle right now, and also internet. So internet is also considered as one of transportation mode. Yeah, because if you buying something from Amazon as a PDF or ebooks, so they don't deliver you in conventional way, they will deliver you through internet. So many references consider internet as one of transportation mode right now. Okay. So after in distribution center will send or will distribute into smaller distribution center or smaller wholesaler. In these pictures, those terms is called retail stores or retailers. They will distribute it from distribution center. Mainly, they will use trucks, okay? Because one distribution centers usually offers or services for several retailers. So if you talk about like Indomaret or Alfamart, they will have a distribution center maybe in Sidoarjo. They serve or they distribute the products of Indomaret and Alfamart into several regions. Surabaya will serve by Sidoarjo DC, Gresik will serve by Sidoarjo DC, something like that. So I think you must found out in streets when you are using your motorcycle, there is truck for Indomaret or from Alfamart. But Alfamart is using outsourcing trucks. Yeah, it's called Bilog. So Bilog is the third party logistic that used by Alfamart. So they don't manage the logistic functions. Yeah, they don't manage the logistic function inside the company. Else they use third party logistic to operate their logistic functions. Is it okay? That's okay. That's common terms. Yeah, third party logistic. But right now is the third party logistic terms is moving into fourth party logistics. So from distribution center, it's already managed by outsourcing company. It is called fourth party logistics. So if we talk about third party logistic, they only serve distribution function in here. If we talk about fourth party logistic or 4PL, they serve or they operate logistic function from distribution center until retail stores. Okay, so that's difference of third party logistic and fourth party logistic. Yeah. So many so many terms that in 2010 is still called by 3PL, but later in 2020 it's moved into 4PL. So I think you must know the difference from difference about the difference 3PL with 4PL. Okay, so this arrow is explaining what move in from upstream to downstream. Okay, so if we talk about factory, then we talk about the upstream of supply chain management. If we talk about customer, then we talk about the downstream of supply chain management. Okay, so there is upstream, there is downstream. Like a river, ya, like a river atau sungai, biasanya kita sebut hulu dan hilir. Okay, so in English, we call this upstream and call this downstream. Okay. So what flows from upstream into downstream in supply chain management This is materials, which is products or services that flows from upstream into downstream. Okay. While what moves or what flows from downstream to upstream? Yeah. What is going reverse? Yeah. What is going forward is materials, which is products or services. What is going reverse or what is going from downstream into upstream? Which is money, okay, or transaction utility. Yeah, we can use money, or maybe right now we can use cryptocurrency. Yeah, right now we are not dealing with only real money from banking. We can also use cryptocurrency. We can use NFT, yeah, something like that. Those are called as transaction utility or financing utility. And what is moving vice versa? Okay, it is moving forward and it is moving backwards. Okay, it is moving forward and it is moving reverse. This is information. Okay, so upstream deliver information into downstream. Okay, so my products that I offer to you is something like that. Okay, like Samsung launching their new phone. Or Apple launching their new phone, okay? They also give you information or deliver you information. What is important of iPhone 13 Pro Max? What is the difference between iPhone 13 and iPhone 12? Something like that. There is information flowing from upstream into downstream, okay? While information flowing into downstream into upstream is information that comes from the customer perspective. Okay, while they launch and promote their new product, the Apple team maybe gather the critics or recommendation from customers where their customers needs a new phone that have a better camera maybe, or they want a new phone that have a better VGA, so they can playing a game in their gadget. Okay, so that information is flowing from downstream to upstream. Okay, so that information is very valuable because based on that information, the company or the plant will doing the research and development for their new products, maybe iPhone 14 or iPhone 15, something like that. Okay, their new development of their products is based on discussion or critics or recommendation from the customer perspective. So in these pictures, information is picturized by vice versa or forward and backwards flow of things, yeah, information. Okay, which is in factory, we call upstream, and in customer perspective, we call downstream. Okay, so this is also the terms. This is from Hang Sim books. You can also find the books online. So if we talk about global supply chain management, yeah, global supply chain management is the big circle where is there are two circles inside. Yeah, the first one is logistic management. It's part of global supply chain management. Inside logistic management, we talk about transport operations, yeah, which is transport operations is concerning with function of 3PL or third party logistics, while logistic management is function that right now is also considered or served by fourth party logistics or 4PL. Okay, so if we talk about global supply chain management, we can separate supply chain management with logistics management. That's why in many books or in many college, yeah, if we learn about supply chain management, we also learn about logistics, which is the courses they offer to the students is not supply chain management, but logistics and supply chains management, because we cannot separate supply chain management with logistic functions. Okay. Okay. Any question? Ada pertanyaan teman-teman? Okay, if you are in home, they have a questions, you can write it in chat column, yeah. Okay, I will continue my materials. Right now, we will talk about key aspects of supply chains. Yeah. What is the important things that we need to know about 2020 supply chains? Okay, in early stage of supply chains, what is the key aspect that we really need to know? Yeah. Okay. The first one is sustainability. Okay. These terms is don't mention or maybe is not popular in around 2000 or 2010. It is not popular. But after we all suffer from COVID-19, yeah, something like that. And right now we are facing the big war from Russia to Ukraine. Sustainability is kind of big issue in supply chain. Yeah. If you are reading the news right now, the oil price is reached $115 per barrel. This is the all-time high since 2014. Okay, this is the all-time high value since 2014. You can imagine because of that war. The price of wheat, gandum, yeah, the price of wheat is expensive right now. Company like Indofood, Wings, many company that produce noodles or flour, they are suffering because the biggest country that produce wheat is Russia. So if you feel that war is not a direct effect into our country is a big mistake, yeah. So in global supply chains, if there is a force majeure or there is a condition that happen into one country and one country is considered as a big country for sourcing, they supply many materials into other country, so global supply chain management will also disrupt. Okay. So first one is sustainability. Many reference mention about sustainability supply chains, resilient supply chains, because this is also more and more important right now because we are facing a terms that you may already heard, which is Sustainable Development Goals or SDG. Yeah, many country start to aware about SDG, so they start supply chains in terms of green supply chain. Okay, supply chain that consider environment. Okay, they need to responsible for their child, for their future childhood. They have responsible into this. Okay, that's why we talk about sustainability. In sustainability, it is known as triple bottom line. Yeah, this term maybe you are rarely heard. There is a term that triple bottom line, which is if we concern about sustainability in supply chain management, we consider these three. Yeah, the first one is profit, the second one is planet, okay, and the third one is people. Or in several references, it's mentioned as 3Ps, 3P, 3Ps, okay? Profit, planet, and people. Yeah, if we carried out sustainability as one of issue in supply chain management, we still need to concern about our profit, yeah? Because we are doing business, we have to make a profit. Yeah, profit is an expression of the performance that leads to economic and financial sustainability. Yeah, if we are doing business, we have to make sure this kind of market or this kind of products will give us or will direct us into the financial sustainability. Yeah, if you are planning to do a business and you find out that market is not sustained, and you should not go into that market. Yeah. So in sustainability, we have to concern about our profit or financial sustainability. Okay. And its development prospects in the medium to long term. Okay. So in sustainability, we still need to concern about our profit. The second one is climate or environmental issues. Okay. As you can see right now, like China, many companies still use coal as their energy resource. Yeah. Where coal is energy resource that result carbon that have a bad influence and bad effects to climate change. Yeah. That's why right now climate or environmental issue is considered as one of important things to do in business. Yeah. Many city or many towns in Europe, they are planning to move into green cities or green town. Yeah. One of city in Sweden called Gothenburg, the mayor of that city is already mentioned that in 2030, all of the production or industrial facility is using the green energy resource in 2030. So many city and many town in Europe are already concerned about this. And I think in around 10 or 20 years later, Indonesia will also concern something like it. Yeah. That's why I deliver these materials to you to open your mind that triple bottom line is begin the big concern for many cities in Europe and also maybe in Asia for maybe 5 to 10 years later. Okay. Planet is explaining or refers to the performance that guarantees. Yeah. Refers to the performance that guarantees environmental sustainability. Okay, so we have to guarantee that our business process is not giving a bad influence or bad effect into environment. Yeah, we have responsible to protect our childhood in the future. Yeah, giving their still a best life in planet Earth in their future. Yeah, we have responsible. We have responsibility. In terms of environmental protection and the overall impact of the business on the environment. Okay. The third one is people or social aspects. Yeah. As you already know that most of works is converting from people into machine. Yeah. If you are using a car, then you take a toll road. Right now in toll gate, we rarely see people that accept your money and give change your money. Yeah, we already use the e-toll. So you can imagine how many people that converting their jobs from doing that task in toll gate into something else. Hopefully, it's not firing or layoffing the employee. Hopefully, like Jasa Marga have different scheme for the people or the employee that works on toll gate. Yeah. Coffee like Abidin. Do you still running your business in coffee? Oh, it's already sold. In Instagram, I often see that many barista works is converting into robot machine. So robot right now can give you or can offer you kopi susu gula aren. They are not human works again. It's robot machine. Yeah. Other food like sushi. Japan already have a store of sushi store. That for making process of sushi, they don't use people again. They use the robot machine. Okay. So if we talk about sustainability, because in Indonesia there are 271 million people in Indonesia, so we have to concern about the future of our people. Yeah, where are they going to be if all of works, all of jobs is converting from human into machine? Yeah, so if we talk about sustainability, we have to concern about the people or social aspects. Okay, social aspects is referred as connected to the performance that measures the social impact of the business. Yeah, that measures the social impact of the business in terms of social equality and cohesion. Yeah, social equality means that we don't cut off or we don't discriminate the gender. Yeah, like this job is considered as a man works. Yeah, or this job is considered as woman works. Yeah, we have to do social equality. Also in civil servant works, yeah, PNS also have disability equality. Yeah, people that have a kind of disability conditions, they have to be part of the civil servant in Indonesia. Yeah, in Surabaya also, in Jakarta also. Yeah, so not only social equality or gender equality, it's also like disability equality also become concerned in many areas. Okay, economic prosperity, protections, and the promotion of fundamental rights. Okay, these three or three P's, profit, planet, and people, is known as triple bottom line. Okay, I will bold it. Yeah. Triple bottom line. Okay, next ones after sustainability, we will talk about resilient supply chain. Okay, resilience. Okay, it is considered issues which are, so if we talk about resilience, like we are talking about agility. Yeah, like football player like Messi, he has a good agility. Yeah, he can pass many defender. Yeah, he can pass many defender. We talk about agility or resilience. Yeah, in other terms it's called resilience. If we talk about resilience, there are several issues that we are considered. The first one is cost efficiency. Okay, cost efficiency carries several implications, such as refer to high volume, lower variety. Okay, high volume, lower variety. It means that if we are doing business in resilience works, in resilience world, yeah, we cannot offer the customer many variety. Okay, like fashion line like H&M or Zara, they are starting to minimize their variety. Yeah, from maybe like clothes, yeah, something like clothes. Before 2020, they have kind of 10 variety. Maybe they decrease right now the variety into 5 variety of clothes. Yeah, and they convert the lower variety into high volume. Yeah. A business line, a fashion line like H&M doing like this, yeah. They are using high volume and lower variety. Okay. in order to have cost efficiency. Minimizing inventory and initiate the development of lean management principle. Okay, why is minimizing inventory? Yeah, because the variety is beginning into the low variety. We are assume that all of that variety is accepted into markets. Okay, customer that variety is that expected by the customers. We do not gamble again. Okay, as you may know that fashion industry is a industry that push that products into the markets. Yeah, that's why each year they launch their new products or they involve in several fashion week. Yeah, currently there is Paris Fashion Week. Yeah, Paris Fashion Week. There is Milan Fashion Week. There is what else? New York Fashion Week. Yeah, in that fashion week they push their products. So that's why the customer can have perspective that oh, that clothes is currently becoming trend right now. Because the company push the trend into you, push the mode into you. Yeah. With the high of variety. Right now, most of company, Zara, H&M, they are facing the resilient supply chain management. That's why they start to begin low their variety and convert to the high volume. Okay, so don't be ashamed, yeah. If in the street or in the mall you find a person that have a clothes something like you, yeah, because the variety is beginning low right now and the volume is starting to be high. Yeah. Okay, the second one is speed. Okay, if we talk about agility, we can separate agility with speed. Okay. What speed is expected into resilient supply chain? Short lead time. Okay, short lead time and supply chain synchronization across the various stakeholder in principle. Okay, short lead time. Yeah. If before the era of COVID, before the era of war, we still expect customer to wait our product. Okay, we still have quite a long lead time. Right now, we can offer something like that again to the customer. Customers need the product that have a short lead time. It means if you have short lead time for your business process or your production process, they will have a short lead time also in market. Okay, so the product availability of your products is high. Okay, so we want to make sure availability of our product into markets. That's why we have to make a shorter lead time. Okay, and supply chain synchronization across the various stakeholders in principles. Again, in definition that I already mentioned before, we have to do coordination and collaboration. Okay, they both need to do synchronization along supply chains. Okay, if we talk about, I will later show you what kind of supply chains involve in a global supply chain management. Yeah, if we talk about company like Boeing, yeah, they produce aeroplane, yeah, aircraft. They are not having a local supply chain. Yeah, they are using global supply chains. Like something, maybe the engine jet, yeah, the jet engines is sourcing from the Singapore, yeah, while the body or the propeller is from the Sweden. Maybe the cockpit is from the USA, yeah. So they are doing the global supply chain management. We are not doing local supply chain management again, yeah. If we talk about something business like coffee shop business, most of supply chains is handled by our Indonesian supply chains. We can buy coffee beans from Tokopedia. That Tokopedia also have coffee beans from villagers or from Sumatra, Aceh. It's still performing local or regional supply chains. But if we talk about company like Boeing, Mercedes-Benz, BMW, Airbus, they are all using global supply chain management. That's why supply chain synchronization is emerging into important things. Yeah. Okay, so there is a term that called order winners. Yeah. Winners are those company that are able to flexibly produce a large variety products with high speed. Okay, if you want to be a winner in current market, yeah, in current market, you have to be flexible, yeah, to produce a large variety of products with high speed. Yeah, it means shorter lead time. Yeah, optimally responding to observed or forecasted market demand. Yeah, that's why information needs to be flow. Yeah, needs to be flow from downstream to upstream in order to we can do forecasted market demand. Yeah, we already know some of quantitative approach, yeah, that we already learned in PPIC for forecasting method. The third one is customer orientation. Yeah, push market gradually change into a pull market. This is what I mentioned you before about fashion industry, that before this they are using push market. They are push the trend into you, so the customer have a perspective that oh, this cloth is begin trend right now, because they are using a push market. Right now we are facing into a pull market, which mean is customer driven market. Okay, custom what customer needs, that is the product that I produce. Okay, customer driven market or data driven market. Okay, so maybe in many reference or in many articles you read about data driven or data driven or customer driven, which is considered as a pull market. So we pull data from customer, we pull data from downstream into our upstream supply chain. Okay. More attention was given to product quality. Okay. Right now, quality is important. Yeah. Again, recognized as a distinguished feature and important factor in gaining customer loyalty. Okay. More attention was given to product quality. Why is product quality is important right now? Okay. You guys already take pengendalian mutu ya, courses. Already take 2018 already ya, 2019 already. Oh, this semester ya. If we talk about quality, so we have to make sure that our production facility is good. Okay, our standard, yeah, Mehmet, Rian already learn about control chart, yeah, already learn about control chart. We have to make sure that our product is confirmed, yeah, conforming product, produknya seragam, yeah. If we talk about aqua bottle that have a specific content of 600 milliliter, yeah, so we have to make sure all of our products is containing 600 milliliters. Okay, we can have a deviation. Maybe it's not exact 600 milliliters. Maybe 580 or maybe 610, yeah, 610 milliliters. It's acceptable based on the policy of the company. Okay, the products is considering as acceptable product if these products have or follow the rules that containing water inside the bottle of aqua is around 1910 milliliters and 590 milliliters. We have upper control limit and lower control limits. Okay, what is the implication? Yeah, what is the consequence? If we are applying the rules or policy something like that, we have to make sure our production process, our production facility is very good. Okay, that's why a good quality product usually have a quite expensive product. Yeah, a good quality products usually have a quite expensive price. Okay, why the price is expensive? Because they have a good quality product. Okay, but right now, high or expensive price of products is also one of concern or not? Is one of direction. So the condition of our market right now is moving into the customer going to expensive products with good quality or a very low price with low quality. So the middle market is begin to disappear. Okay, the customer will go to expensive products. It's okay, I will spend more of my money, but I have a quality products. Or maybe not. I will have a maybe or free or very discounted price products, but the low quality is okay for me. The important one is function. Okay, so the middle market is begin to disappear. Okay, so about this one, any of you watching Indrawan Nugroho channel? Any? Okay, I will find out the YouTube, yeah. It's good. Jawan Nugroho market. Ah, this one. Yang ini. Mehmet, pernah nonton?
Hi, my name is Jordi Filbert. Jadi gue adalah seorang content creator dan streamer Valorant di Indonesia. Jadi semenjak gue kecil, gue suka banget sama yang namanya FPS.
Tahukah Anda bahwa saat ini pasar kelas menengah mulai menghilang? Tren ini disebut dengan market bifurcation, di mana pasar terbelah menjadi dua, yaitu pasar kelas bawah dan pasar kelas atas. Sementara pasar kelas menengah semakin mengecil. Jika perusahaan Anda saat ini menyasar segmen kelas menengah, mungkin Anda sudah ngerasain sendiri ya, betapa berdarah-darahnya persaingan untuk memenangkan dompet pelanggan di pasar tersebut. Seperti apa sih market bifurcation itu dan apa yang perlu Anda lakukan untuk bisa mengakalinya? Yuk, kita cari tahu. Hasil survei Deloitte pada tahun 2018 terhadap lebih dari 2.000 responden di Amerika Serikat menemukan bahwa para retailer yang menjual produknya dengan harga nanggung, yang memberikan nilai melalui kombinasi harga dan promosi, umumnya berkinerja lebih buruk daripada mereka yang menjual dengan harga serendah mungkin, atau mereka yang memberikan nilai melalui penawaran produk atau pengalaman unggulan yang unik dengan harga premium. Dalam 5 tahun, pendapatan para retailer premium melonjak 81%. Sementara pendapatan para retailer berbasis harga meningkat 37% selama periode yang sama. Itu kontras dengan retailer yang nanggung, yang ternyata pendapatannya hanya meningkat 2% saja. Selain itu, Deloitte juga menemukan bahwa konsumen lebih cenderung merekomendasikan retailer premium atau retailer berbasis harga daripada retailer nanggung. Hal itu menunjukkan bahwa para retailer di kedua ujung spektrum lebih selaras dengan kebutuhan pelanggan yang tengah berubah dan juga lebih baik dalam memenuhi harapan konsumen daripada retailer yang berada di tengah dan nanggung tadi. Terlepas dari tren ekonomi makro yang positif di Amerika, ternyata 10 tahun terakhir ini sebenarnya merupakan periode yang buruk bagi kebanyakan warga Amerika. Mereka yang berada dalam kelompok berpenghasilan rendah mendapati dirinya berjuang untuk memenuhi kebutuhan. Sementara kelompok berpenghasilan menengah menemukan kemampuan belanjanya semakin mengecil. Hal itu disebabkan karena biaya-biaya yang melonjak secara drastis. Biaya perawatan kesehatan misalnya telah meningkat 62%, pendidikan 41%, makanan 17%, dan perumahan 12%. Trend bifurcation nggak hanya terjadi di Amerika Serikat. Negara-negara di Eropa juga mengalami hal yang sama. Para ahli di International Labour Organization menemukan hubungan langsung antara peningkatan ketidaksetaraan pendapatan yang terus terjadi di negara-negara Eropa dengan berkurangnya kelompok konsumen berpenghasilan menengah di negara-negara tersebut. Di tahun 2019, Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development atau OECD mengeluarkan laporan yang punya kesimpulan yang sama. Masyarakat kelas menengah di negara-negara yang tergabung dalam OECD juga mengalami erosi, alias menciut jumlahnya. Lalu bagaimana dengan Asia? Berbeda dengan jumlah kelas menengah di Amerika dan Eropa yang terus menurun, ternyata kelas menengah di Asia itu justru meningkat. Brookings Institute memproyeksikan jumlah kelas menengah di Amerika itu turun dari 17% di 2020 menjadi 13% di 2030. Lalu di Eropa itu akan turun dari 20% di 2020 menjadi 14% di 2030. Sementara itu, jumlah kelas menengah di Asia justru diproyeksikan akan naik dari 54% di 2020 menjadi 65% di 2030. Nah, kalau Indonesia gimana? Data dari Bank Dunia menunjukkan bahwa kelompok kelas menengah di Indonesia bertumbuh paling cepat dibandingkan kelompok lainnya, yaitu 10% per tahun antara 2002 hingga 2016. Bank Dunia mendefinisikan kelompok kelas menengah di Indonesia itu adalah mereka yang punya pengeluaran antara 7,5 hingga 38 dolar AS per hari atau 100.000 hingga 530.000 rupiah per harinya. Dan saat ini setidaknya ada 52 juta orang Indonesia atau 1 dari setiap 5 warga Indonesia masuk ke dalam kelompok kelas menengah. Kelas menengah ini telah menjadi pendorong utama pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia karena konsumsi kelompok tersebut tumbuh sebesar 12% setiap tahun sejak tahun 2002. Dan sekarang mewakili hampir setengah dari seluruh konsumsi rumah tangga di Indonesia. Karenanya, maka kemudian di bulan Juli 2020 lalu, Bank Dunia pun menaikkan status Indonesia menjadi negara berpenghasilan menengah atas. Kepala Makroekonomi dan Financial Institute for Development of Economics and Finance atau INDEF, Abdul Manan Pulungan, mengingatkan kita untuk nggak terlalu berbangga dengan kenaikan jumlah kelas menengah di Indonesia. Kelas menengah yang tumbuh itu masih baru, katanya. Mereka hanya kuat di sisi konsumsi, bukan produksi. Sehingga saat ini justru menjadi pasar impor. Pandangan itu selaras dengan laporan McKinsey Global Institute yang menyebutkan bahwa pertumbuhan ekonomi Indonesia bertumpu pada faktor konsumsi. Tidak seperti macan Asia lainnya yang pertumbuhannya lebih mengandalkan sektor ekspor dan manufaktur. Kelas menengah Indonesia itu gemar mengkoleksi kartu kredit, belanja gaya hidup, dan berhutang untuk belanja konsumtif seperti membeli motor atau gadget baru. Itulah yang kemudian menjadikan kelas menengah di Indonesia sangat rentan terhadap gejolak ekonomi. Data dari Bank Dunia menunjukkan bahwa di Indonesia, hanya 50% dari mereka yang telah menjadi kelas menengah di tahun 2000 mampu untuk bertahan berada di kelas menengah pada tahun 2014. Sementara 40% sisanya turun menjadi aspiring middle class atau calon kelas menengah. Dan 10% lainnya malah justru kembali menjadi kelompok miskin atau rentan miskin pada tahun 2014. Selain perilaku konsumtif, hilangnya kelas menengah itu menurut Sofyan Manandi, Ketua Asosiasi Pengusaha Indonesia APIDO pada saat itu, juga dikarenakan sulitnya usaha kecil untuk bisa merangkak naik menjadi perusahaan kelas menengah. Hal itu disebabkan oleh sulitnya bersaing dengan produk-produk impor. Nah, ketika pandemi COVID-19 masuk ke Indonesia di tahun 2020, kelompok kelas menengah ini langsung goyang kondisi finansialnya. Akibatnya, banyak dari mereka yang kemudian turun kelas menjadi aspiring middle class, bahkan sebagian lagi masuk ke dalam kelompok miskin. Maka di bulan Juli 2021 ini, Bank Dunia menurunkan status Indonesia dari negara berpenghasilan menengah atas, status yang kita baru aja peroleh setahun yang lalu, kembali menjadi negara berpenghasilan menengah ke bawah.
Jujur dulu pas sebelum ada jurnal, waduh men, kita ini cekcoknya udah masalah keuangan doang. Nah,
Berkurangnya jumlah kelompok kelas menengah ini adalah berita buruk bagi bisnis yang menyasar kelas menengah dan mengandalkan pertumbuhan daya beli untuk bertumbuh. Hal ini juga menjelaskan kenapa saat ini terjadi persaingan ekstrim di antara bisnis yang menggarap segmen ini. Dengan pertumbuhan daya beli pelanggan yang terbatas, ya satu-satunya cara bisnis untuk dapat mendongkrak pertumbuhan di atas rata-rata adalah dengan mencoba mengambil pangsa pasar dari para pesaingnya. Jadi apa dong yang perlu Anda lakukan jika perusahaan Anda saat ini menyasar kelompok menengah? Ternyata peritel yang akan sukses menggarap pasar menengah itu adalah mereka yang memahami situasi finansial konsumennya, kemudian menawarkan proposisi nilai yang selaras dengan kebutuhan mereka, baik dari sisi kategori produk maupun dari posisi harganya. Deloitte melakukan kajian lanjutan di tahun 2019 dengan melibatkan 3.000 responden dan 1.100 merek. Tujuannya adalah untuk melihat hubungan antara kondisi finansial konsumen dengan produk yang mereka beli. Ada 7 kategori yang mereka teliti, yaitu pakaian, sepatu, makanan, minuman, kesehatan dan kecantikan, elektronik, dan mainan atau hobi. Mereka menemukan bahwa ketika kondisi finansial konsumen meningkat, maka belanja di semua kategori tersebut meningkat. Ya iyalah ya. Tapi, nah nih, yang paling signifikan meningkatnya adalah kategori pakaian, kesehatan dan kecantikan, elektronik, dan mainan atau hobi. Sementara ketika kondisi finansial turun, maka belanja pakaian yang paling mengalami penurunan, diikuti oleh belanja sepatu, minuman, dan elektronik. Sementara untuk kategori makanan, kesehatan dan kecantikan, serta mainan atau hobi, ternyata cenderung tidak berubah pola belanjanya. Dan ketika dilihat lebih dalam ke masing-masing kategori, brand dengan posisi penawaran harga yang seperti apa ya yang berhasil memenangkan dompet pelanggannya? Nah, Deloitte menemukan bahwa untuk kategori pakaian, ternyata fast fashion dan private label yang menawarkan value for money lah yang kemudian akan menang. Sementara untuk kategori sepatu, makanan, kesehatan dan kecantikan, merek value for money dan premium yang kemudian akan memenangkan pasar. Untuk kategori elektronik dan mainan atau hobi, mereka dengan harga yang di tengah justru yang menang. Nah, menariknya untuk minuman, justru merek premium yang akan menang. Deloitte juga menemukan bahwa kecenderungan pembelian online versus membeli di toko itu sangat berkorelasi dengan pendapatan. Konsumen berpenghasilan rendah, 44% lebih berpeluang untuk berbelanja di retail diskon, supermarket, dan department store dibandingkan mereka yang lebih kaya. Sebaliknya, konsumen yang berpenghasilan tinggi, 52% lebih berpeluang untuk belanja secara online. Nah, jadi apa nih strategi Anda untuk bisa memenangkan dompet kelompok kelas menengah ini? Seperti apa bauran produk Anda? Bagaimana strategi harganya? Jawaban dari pertanyaan-pertanyaan itu bisa jadi penentu bagaimana pelanggan kelas menengah akan merespon penawaran Anda. Oh ya, saya penasaran nih, menurut Anda apakah benar pasar kelas menengah di Indonesia itu sudah dan semakin menciut? Dan kira-kira apa alasannya ya? Tulis jawaban Anda di kolom komen di bawah ya, kita diskusi.
Jika Anda menemukan... So based on this video, it's obvious, yeah. Three kind of products or commodity, they move, yeah. The customer moves. If they don't choose the value brands, they choose the premium brands. Okay. So the middle class or the middle market is begin to disappear. Okay, converting into value brands or low price, yeah, or I call it low price market, and also move to premium brands, or I call it is expensive products market. Okay, so based on this, I can give you a conclusion that customers whether choose the low price products with functional, yeah, with functional purposes, or they choose the good quality products with the expensive price. Yeah. So they concern about the quality of products. Okay. Okay, so in resilient supply chains, we need to concerns, very concerns about the what customers wants, yeah, about what customers wants, and our forecasting methods, the data for our custom for forecasting methods is based on data driven, based on the data from the customers, or called customer driven method. Okay. So the next one is the availability, yeah. The availability is very related with the speed. Okay, shorter lead times, high speed of our products entry or enter the markets. Yeah, and also we have to keep the availability of our products. Okay, so if we if in PPIC, I already mentioned to you that PPIC jobs is we have to produce in right quantity, right products, and also right times. I mentioned three R's in PPIC. Yeah, right times, right quantity, and right products. Okay, maybe four R. Yeah, right place. Yeah, right place, right products, right time, right quantity. But if we talk about the supply chain management, the availability in supply chain management, we have to know about seven R's. Okay, not again four R's, but right now is seven R's. Okay, the first R is right goods or right products. Okay, goods is not artinya baik ya, goods is products. Yeah, right goods as order. Yeah, the second one is right quantity. The third one is right quality. Okay, so we have to choose our business is going to enter which market, a value brands market or premium brands market. Okay, we have to make sure right quality of our products. The fourth one is right time. Okay, the fifth is right place. The sixth is right cost. Okay, right cost is the perspective of our facility. Okay, not right price. Right price is the perspective of our customers. Right cost is the perspective of our production facility. Okay, we have to make sure we produce the product in the right cost. Okay, if we already set the production cost is 80%. Okay, so we have to make sure all of the cost involved in the production facility is considered as 80%. Okay, and the seventh, yeah, right sustainable impact or footprint. Okay, I already mentioned about the sustainability. There is one term is in sustainability aspect, yeah, in sustainability area called carbon footprint. Okay, I will mention later in exact meeting. I will talk about sustainability supply chain management. Yeah. Also, I will mention about the footprint. Okay. Based on all statement mentioned before, by this time you understand that supply chain is a complex system. Okay. Why is supply chain a complex system? Because you have to make sure about seven R's. Okay. We have to make sure our company, our production facility, guarantees that seven R's is explained and is applied by our production facility. Yeah, doing one R or three R's in PPIC, yeah, or four R's in PPIC, you already it demonstrates you that how complex it is. Yeah, how complex it is. Only four R's, but in supply chain management, you have to make sure seven R's is applied. Okay, so that's why supply chain is considered as a complex system. Yeah, that's why if you are reading papers or articles about supply chain management, most of the method or most of the approach that are used by those articles is using mathematical models, operation research, yeah, because complex systems need a computations approach. Okay, that delivering or fulfilling the value needs to considers consider numerous aspects. Later, availability will affect several policies applied by companies, such as service level, inventory, and decoupling point. Okay, service level I already mentioned, yeah, in one of meeting in PPIC, I already mentioned about service level. It relates to the reorder point. If you are still remember, yeah, we are using service level. using the alpha table, ya. Yeah. We are using alpha table. We are looking for Z value, ya. Yeah. So we look for about the safety stock and reorder point. The accumulation of safety stocks and reorder point is considering as a service level. Okay, this is SEOR reference model. Yeah, this is model that mostly used to explain what activity involved in all of the players in supply chains. Okay, so there is a supplier side. Okay, there is a supplier and supplier suppliers. Okay, supplier suppliers is the supplier that give materials into suppliers. Yeah, so suppliers is tier 2, suppliers is tier 1. Okay, ferry raw materials is from suppliers. Okay, ferry raw materials convert into raw materials from the suppliers. Okay, yeah. Then suppliers deliver the raw materials into our company. Okay, in the middle there is terms of your company. Then our company deliver our finished products or maybe half finished product, yeah, that concern by the end products of our company into customers or maybe customer. Okay, customer here we can also assume that customer is wholesaler or distributors or wholesaler, yeah, that is customer. Okay, customers is considered as end customers or capital customers. Okay, yeah. So what are they doing in supply chains based on their role, yeah, in supply chains. Suppliers, yeah, they are doing plan, they are doing sourcing, they are doing producing or make, yeah, they are doing deliver, and there is a term of return. Okay, in your company you are using you are doing sourcing, you are doing making or producing, and you are doing delivering. Yeah, this is all of the activities. They are done by players along supply chains. Yeah, this is considered as SEOR reference model. Okay. Okay, the last chapters. Yeah, the last chapters. I will talk about disruptors and contemporary supply chains. Yeah, as you may know right now, there are many of disruptors. Yeah, in this supply chains right now. Okay. I will begin these chapters by this slides. Okay, yeah. The first one on the top left, yeah, on the top left, you are watching kind of Grab driver, yeah, kind of Grab driver or maybe Gojek driver. We are considering the company is online transportation company. Okay, yeah. In fact, yeah, the company right now is considering as largest taxi company. Okay, but owns no cars. They don't have any cars. Okay, yeah. Second pictures, Netflix. Yeah, anyone here watching Netflix or Disney Plus? Maybe all of ya, yeah. Mostly ya. Yeah. They are considering as largest movie house right now. Okay, yeah. Netflix, Squid Game, yeah, many movies. But owns no theaters. Yeah, they don't have theaters like XXE. They don't have theaters like what else? CGV. They still have theaters, but Netflix, they don't have theaters, physical theaters. Yeah. The third one, Amazon. Yeah, considering one of online marketplace company. Yeah, beside Alibaba. Okay, they are considering as largest retailers, but holds no inventory. There is no holding cost. There is no carrying cost in their company. Yeah. The fourth one, Zoom, what we are doing right now, what we are using right now, yeah, considering is what online telecommunication company, yeah, the owner of Zoom, yeah, from China, is right now considering as top 10 richest people, yeah, richest person, only in 2 years maybe, yeah, they are considering largest telecommunication company right now, but has no physical infrastructure. If we are talking about telecom, they have what else? Tiang telepon, yeah. They still have, yeah. They still have office Ya, behind our building there is SBS. There is the office. In front of our building there is the office. Ya. But what about Zoom? They only have a servers, ya. Yeah? They only have a servers and the headquarters. Enough. Okay? The last one, TikTok, ya. Yeah? Maybe some of you are TikTok players, ya. Yeah? TikTok is right now considering is online content provider company. Okay? Almost beat Instagram, ya. Yeah? Right now Instagram is following TikTok. Ya. Yeah? TikTok is using most of them are video content, ya. Yeah? Right now Instagram is moving into photos, they are converting into reels. Ya. Yeah? New algorithm of Instagram, if you are using reels as your content sharing, they will attract more viewers than photos. So Instagram right now is following what TikTok's doing. Okay. TikTok is now considering as largest content provider company, but develops no content on its own. Okay. So my question is, any one of you can mention what is the similarity? What is the similarity from those five pictures in this slide? One of the obvious similarity. Any one of you can mention what is the obvious similarity? Apa kesamaan yang paling mencolok dari kelima gambar yang ada di slide ini? What is the obvious similarity? Any one of you? They don't have inventory. Almost. Hampir.
Technology company.
Technology. Which technology? Technology apa? Which technology?
Gimana? Bisa pakai bahasa Indonesia.
Boleh.
Iya. Jadi. Which technology? Lebih seperti jasa karena. Apa ya, mereka tidak, bukan perusahaan manufaktur, begitu Pak. Dan kalau menurut saya, ya seperti Netflix, Amazon, Zoom itu kan termasuk dalam Nasdaq di mana kategori perusahaan teknologi gitu Pak.
Oke, okay. Almost. Abidin? Dijalankan sama penggunanya sendiri. Menggunakan? Why that can be happen? Kenapa kok itu bisa terjadi? Because of what? Hendra? Nah. Because the words that I mentioned in all of that picture, yeah, because online, internet enables it, yeah. That's why in first of the slides I mentioned that internet right now is considered as one of transportation mode. Okay, if you are still remember in supply chains, transportation is considered as enablers. Okay. Later maybe I will give you my materials in my training, ya. Yeah. I have a training in 2020, ya, yeah, Mas Hendra, ya, yeah, that you are involved and Mehmet involves 2020, ya, yeah. I have a training in 2020. Maybe I will share my materials. In that materials, in that presentation, I mentioned that transportation is called as enablers in supply chains. Okay, why supply chains can be works? Because the materials or the products is moving from one place into another place, from one player into another player. Because of what? Because there is a transportation mode. Okay, and right now internet is considered as one of transportation mode. okay? Because it is happening in online, okay? Because it operates online, then it can be possible. Okay, so one of obvious similarity, this began emerging as one of biggest technology company, or maybe right now Amazon become the biggest retailers, yeah, and where Jeff Bezos is considered as five people in Forbes, yeah, five people richest in the world, yeah, because they are doing their business online, yeah, they give no boundaries in their business, okay, so many companies like telecommunications in Indonesia, yeah, Telkom, Indosat, XL, they are moving into digital telco company. Okay, they are moving into digital telco company. Okay, because they are doing the business online. So my point is, internet is becoming one of the biggest disruptors right now in supply chain era. Okay. Okay, digitization in logistics and supply chain operations. All of this can be doing doing by your phone or by your laptop, yeah, using internet. Digitization. Okay. Okay, the first one, digitization in logistics and supply chain operations, is e-commerce and last mile delivery. Anyone knows about e-commerce? What is relation about e-commerce and last mile delivery? Ada yang tahu hubungannya? Kalau e-commerce kan kita semua pakai, ya, Tokopedia, Shopee, apalagi Lazada, ya. Nah, my question is, anyone knows the relation about e-commerce and last mile delivery? Maybe you have heard terms about last mile delivery? Belum pernah, ya. So last mile delivery is delivery that happen along supply chains. It means that it carries out your finished product until in your place. Ya, kayak misalnya kita bicara, teman-teman kalau beli di Shopee itu kan sekarang pilihan kurirnya kadang kita nggak bisa milih, ya. We can choose the courier service. 2 years ago maybe we still can choose among GNT or GNE, ya, or si cepat. Right now we can do it. In most of products, the courier or the delivery service is mentioned as Shopee Express. Yeah, Shopee Express. And the courier that deliver it is from 3PL. Maybe the courier is from GNE, the courier from GNT, but they are assigned as the Shopee courier. Okay, maybe you already heard that some of Shopee courier doing protest because the incentive is very small from that business. Is the incentive is bigger from the logistic company rather than the shopping. Yeah. So that is considered as last mile delivery. So Shopee make sure that the products is arrived or accepted by you. Okay. But they are now using the 3PL's company. They considering as Shopee Express. There is last mile delivery. Yeah, Shopee already doing this. Any of you have tried Sayur Box? Sayur Box? Ada yang pernah pakai Sayur Box? Tani Hub mungkin? Tani Hub? Tani Hub pernah, ya? Nah, kayak Tani Hub itu kan, the courier is from Tani Hub. So they are using e-commerce, yeah. They are using e-commerce. You enter your address, which area you are. So they will plot the courier into your area. They deliver the product by themselves. Okay, that is last mile delivery. Okay. So right now, many e-commerce doing the last mile delivery. Okay, Tani Hub and Sayur Box is very obvious example of e-commerce that they are using last mile delivery. If we are talking about IKEA, Any of you have shop IKEA once in Indonesia? Belum? So I transact several times in IKEA. So in Surabaya there is no IKEA. The biggest store IKEA in Indonesia is at the Alam Sutra in Jakarta. Okay? They are doing omnichannel. Okay? They are doing omnichannel. Okay? They are doing last mile delivery with their trucks. Okay? But also they are applying what I call pickup store or depot in Sidoarjo, in Giant Sidoarjo. Okay? What? Udah tutup? Giant-nya kan? Oke, masih ada kan ya? Udah tutup juga? Waduh. Dulu saya masih ngalamin. Saya, so if you are wanting the delivery cost with free, yeah, if you are want free cost of delivery, you can pick up at the pickup store, at the depot. So they are doing omni channel. Okay. So the term omni is various, yeah, something like various, omni channel. So they are also doing last mile delivery and also the pickup delivery or using the depot. That is e-commerce and last mile delivery. The second one, cloud computing and cloud manufacturing. Anyone knows about cloud computing and cloud manufacturing? Cloud computing first. Cloud computing. Anyone knows about cloud computing? Real time. What is the example of cloud computing? I think most of you are using. Pardon? Google Drive. Another product of Google Drive, another product. Google Forms, Google Docs, Google Sheets. All of them are cloud computing. What is the main purpose of cloud computing, actually? What is the main purpose? I already mentioned before the purpose of cloud computing. Pardon? Cost efficiency. Almost.
To save your data.
Apa?
To save.
Apa Mbak Nurul? Again, sekali lagi.
To save your data.
Save your data. Almost. Not online. What is the main idea? We need to do cloud computing. What is the main idea? What is the main purpose? What is the main urgency? We have to do cloud computing. Nah, coordination and collaboration. That is the point why we are using cloud computing. Because in one file, we can do at the same times in the different place. Yeah, we are at the works, Bila at the house, Prema at the Bali, gitu ya. We are doing the same jobs, yeah. We are doing the same jobs. We are doing one works wherever we are at the different place. Okay, that is the main concern of cloud computing. And right now it is become more and more important because we have to do hybrid something like this. Okay, for me, myself is the staff of IT Telkom Surabaya. I need to do a proportion of WFA and WFO. Okay, so cloud computing is become more and more important. Cloud manufacturing, any of you? Cloud manufacturing. Real-time collab, ya, benar. Any of you? Cloud manufacturing. Right now, there is a terms that you may often heard. Cloud kitchen. Any of you know? Cloud manufacturing and cloud kitchen. Too far. Okay, so I will talk about cloud manufacturing first. Cloud manufacturing is the main idea is the same. Yeah, the main idea is the same. You are doing designing. Yeah, you are doing designing process in collaboration terms. Yeah, in collaboration platform. Maybe like what else? Yeah, Autodesk. Yeah, Autodesk, something like that. Now they are enables the collaboration mode. Okay, so you are doing this by collaborations, yeah, online. Then you can proceed your design into prototype or maybe real product using 3D printers. That is concerned as cloud manufacturing. So you are not. So if you want to make a chair, yeah, if you want to make this chair, you have to buy the iron or the metal. You have to buy the woods, yeah. So many parts or many materials that you have to buy or you have to look for in various suppliers. But in cloud manufacturing, if you want to make these chairs, you only need the bigger 3D printers and you only need the resins. Then you can have the 3D printer chairs, and it's usable, and it's usable. You can sit on it. Yeah, that's considered as cloud manufacturing. Yeah, with one materials, you can have the products that you design collaborative. Okay, what is cloud kitchen? Cloud kitchen actually the main idea is the same, which is collaboration. Yeah, if you are right, have you heard about Boga Group? Have you heard about Boga Group? So right now there are some foods that sells online in Grab that is concerned as one group. Okay, like what else? Yeah, there is Boga Group is the holding company for food like Beef Mafia. What else? So there are several foods that that affiliated with Boga Group. Okay, so if you are buying foods like I already mentioned Beef Mafia, yeah, like already mentioned Beef Mafia, so it is produced in one facility. Yeah, another food that affiliated by Boga Group also produced in the same facility. Okay, so it means that the same facility, it can result or it can produce several foods in several line. Okay, like Sorcelli Group, yeah, Sorcelli Group, SSG. Sorcelli is one of affiliated food in SSG. Another food also affiliated in SSG groups. SSG only have one kitchen. In example, only have one kitchen that can produce various products. That is considered as cloud kitchens, and you can buy it by online. Yeah, you can buy it by online. That is cloud kitchens. Nah, the last one. Yeah, last one. Yeah, societal development, logistics, and supply chain operations. There are two terms. The first one is shared economy. The second one is the circular economy. The first one, have you heard about the shared economy? Shared economy. So right now it begins and it emerged into something very important in supply chain, shared economy. Bahasa Indonesianya apa ya? Sharing economy. Shared economy. Have you heard? Okay. So basically shared economy, I don't know. In Grab still have Grab. Dulu dulu ada namanya itu Grab Hits kalau saya nggak salah. Atau apa ya? Gojek Nebeng apa kalau saya nggak salah ya. So you order one car but you share with other people with the same direction to you. That is shared economy. Yeah. So one resource is used by several person. Yeah. With the same direction to you. The price is very lower. It's lower than you order one car for you by yourself. The price is lower. That is the called shared economy. Okay, so one resource is used by several person. It's used by several people. In Europe, there is a quite unique business of shared economy. So for me, if I'm willing to go to Jakarta, in example, okay, I'm going to Jakarta for 2 days. The online taxi can reach the airport, right? The airport taxi can reach the airport. So I'm using my own cars. Then I park in airports. Okay, for 2 days. For 2 days, my car is doing nothing in the park, yeah. Because I'm in Jakarta, so my car is empty, doing nothing in car park. So in shared economy, there is a business process in airports. So while I was away in Jakarta, my car in the airports can be used by anyone. Okay, in return, I don't have to pay the car park. I don't have to pay car park free. Okay, the fee for the car park is free because I let anyone use my car. Okay, then it is managed by the airports. There is the business something like this. I think in Indonesia is not applicable because. Many Indonesian feel that their car is private for their self, yeah, something. Yeah, that's share economy. The second one is circular economy. Anyone of you heard about circular economy? Circular economy. So circular is cyclic. Circular economy. Have you heard about that? Circular economy. So the materials that flow from upstream to downstream back into the upstream, circular economy. Have you heard about that? Anyone? No? So the circular economy, something like Coca-Cola doing their business. Okay? So they own their bottle, yeah? They own their glass bottle, so they produce the Coca-Cola, then they distribute into many retailers. Okay, when the glass bottle is empty, they take back the glass bottle. That is circular economy, or it is called reverse logistics. Okay, in circular economy, it's bigger than this. Okay, circular economy is this idea is want to be applied in many products, not only Coca-Cola or bottling company. Okay, so if we what I call, yeah, galon juga. Tapi gini, jadi yang kalau yang ingin disampaikan dari circular economy adalah kalau barangnya itu adalah barang habis pakai. Kalau kayak Coca-Cola kan barangnya tidak habis pakai. Jadi kan bottle-nya bisa di take back. Oke. Nah, circular economy itu pinginnya adalah ketika barangnya sudah habis pakai, waste-nya atau sampahnya itu masih bisa digunakan lagi, oke, untuk kepentingan customers-nya. Jadi customer tidak hanya memberikan uang ke company-nya, tapi mereka juga bisa mendapatkan uang dari produk yang dia gunakan. Okay, so something like they are buying sunlight. Okay, something like sunlight. So sekarang banyak ibu-ibu gitu ya di perumahan gitu pakai bungkus sunlight-nya kemudian ditata, dijahit kemudian jadi tas. Okay. So the waste of the products become the economic opportunities for the customers. Okay. So it's circular. So the company have the money and the customer also have the money. So the money begins vice versa relationship, like information. Information flows from upstream to downstream and flows from the downstream to upstream. Now the money is also begin the vice versa relations. Okay, money flows from downstream to upstream and also the money can flows from the upstream to downstream by doing the what I call recycle, yeah, by doing the recycle process, something like that. Or maybe the sunlight itu apa ya, Unilever. Or maybe the Unilever wants to take back. Okay, they take back the packaging of sunlight, yeah, the packaging of sunlight. They take back, they convert into rupiahs. Maybe 1 kilos of sunlight back convert into 300 rupiahs. They give to the household. So the circular economy. Well, Unilever can have the packaging back into their plant. Maybe they can use the package. They burn the package maybe, and they convert into the alternative energy. Okay. Sekarang ada istilahnya PLTS, pembangkit listrik tenaga sampah. So they convert the waste into the electricity. There is circular economy. Okay. Okay, this is the last slide for today. Any question, guys? So in the first meeting, I explained several ideas. I explained several terms that right now is emerging into something important in supply chains right now. Yeah, disruptors, sustainability, resilience, triple bottom line. Yeah. Something you may not know, not heard before. Yeah. One of my objective for this course is that all of you can learn and know some new perspective, some new terms. Yeah, in recent supply chains. One of my objectives is like that. Okay, any question? Okay, kalau tidak ada, if there is no questions, I will end this meeting right now. Hold on, I will stop recording.